Hello. Today I'm going to talk about a project funded by the NIH Brain Initiative to highlight some of the value of multidisciplinary approaches to neuroscience. So the project that I'm going to talk about today is a project that is carried by three laboratories, myself, Laboratory of Carlos Loes at Caltech, Adrienne Ferhol at University of Washington, and Tim Gardner at University of Oregon. And the theme of the project is neuronal circuit resilience, meaning how the brain manages to maintain reliable behaviors with unreliable neurons. So an introduction. So usually for the last maybe 40 or 50 years, there has been this general thing that people think that the brain is a computer, a biological computer. We think that perhaps this is not the best idea or the best way to think about the brain. And as you will see later for the data that we have been gathering for this project, we think that perhaps it would be valuable to have a different perspective, maybe perhaps to think of the brain as a river, in the sense that in the same way that water flows through a river, information flows through the brain. So what do we mean by resilience? So of course, we know that the brain is made of neurons, that they are connected to each other in very complex circuits through these elements called synapses. And when neurons are working, everything is fine. However, we also know that with disease or with aging, or simply that neurons, sometimes they are less reliable than electronic components of a computer. So what we are interested in is what happens, how is it possible that the brain can keep, let's say, a stable behavior over a long period of time with neurons that are either unreliable or they die or they get sick. So the idea would be like this. So you have this brain circuit. What happens? What is the function of this brain circuit if selective of those elements either disappear or become very unreliable? So what this means is that, of course, information has to flow through the brain. So if we have now these elements that are missing or they are not functioning properly, how does information keep flowing through the brain to produce these behaviors? Now, the analogy of the river. So a river fundamentally is a way of transferring water from snow in the mountains to the ocean, and it has to go through what we call rivers. But rivers are actually not straight the way that we think in cartoons. Rivers are very, very complicated structures. And in particular, there is a physical analog, which I think that is a valuable way about the brain, which is meanders. So the way that water flows through the river is actually not straight. We know that rivers are relatively sinuous structure, but actually even with time, these sinuous structures become more and more exacerbated to the point that sometimes they completely get abandoned. So for instance, here, this is like an actual picture of a river somewhere in the United States that you can see that in the blue and green lines. So that was the trajectory of the river in 1935 or 1964. You see that it's making a big detour. However, something happened approximately in 1997 in the lines that are in yellow, that meander was completely abandoned and it just keeps flowing in the same way in 2008. The point here is that you can have the same transfer of water from one point to another through very different trajectories. So we think that one of the fundamental properties of the brain is that information can flow through the brain, not through very fixed trajectories, but also through very flexible trajectories. And that is exactly the question that we are trying to study with our project. So for this, we are focusing on this experimental animal called the zebra finch. The zebra finch is a songbird. You can see them here. So there is a male and a female. Only the males sing, the females do not sing. The main reason that we are interested in studying this animal is because it has a song that is actually very advantageous for the kind of questions that we are studying for the following reasons. One, it has this song that can be measured very, very precisely with physical equipment. It's called spectrograms. And another thing that is very interesting is that this song is actually very simple. So what you are going to hear in a second is several renditions of the song of this animal, one after another, so that you have an idea. Each song is less than 1 second, but you are going to hear how the animal sings several songs, one after another, after another. Let's hear about it. So as you can hear, the songs actually are not particularly interesting. But the key thing is that they are very, very stereotypical. We will hear more about this in a minute. And they are very easy to analyze. Another important thing is that we know for that makes these animals very advantageous is that we know very well the part of the brains that are involved in the production and the perception of and learning of this song. So now we have a situation, we have a very strong behavior that can be very, very precisely quantified, and we also have a lot of information about the parts of the brain that are involved in the production of this song. Now, one thing that is important is these animals are actually not born with these songs, as you heard a minute ago. Actually, the animals have to listen to the song of the father. It's only the males that sing. And then over a long period of time, more or less from 30 days after hatch until 90 days after hatch, they practice and practice for thousands and thousands of times until slowly they manage to copy the song of the father. So on top, you see the song of a father. You can see that there are these structures that you can very intuitively see that they appear to be like syllables. In this case, you can see more or less that they're going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 units that we are going to call syllables. But the important thing is that when these animals, when they are starting to sing the song, actually what they sound, what they sing sounds really bad. You will see in a second. Okay, so this is the song of the father on top. So this is what the animal has to copy. Now, the first time that the animal attempts to produce a song, this is what it sounds. You can see that it's highly distorted. Now, over thousands of repetitions, the animal gets a bit better and produces this other type of song. Again, all of this is the same animal, and you can see that it starts to sound a bit better. It is still not quite there, but you can see that it's approaching the song of the father until eventually, approximately by 90 or 100 days after hatch, you have a copy that is virtually identical to the song that the father was producing. So this is very important. This process of singing is not innate. The animal has to learn to produce the song by copying and practicing over a long period of time. Now, the key thing is that, so I mentioned that these animals have to practice to copy the song, but what is remarkable is that once the animals learn the song is extremely stable. So for instance, here you have several examples, several spectrograms of the song of the same animal at different times. So this is a full adult animal, it has already learned its song, and then at 0 days, 60 days later, or 204 days later, 240 days later. As you can see, visually, you don't really see that there is any obvious difference between the song produced in, you know, 240 days apart. So the song is extremely stereotypical, extremely stable. Now, I mentioned we know pretty well the anatomy and the parts of the brain that are involved in the production of the song, and we are going to focus in this particular structure on the top of the brain called HVC. And another thing that we know is a relatively small nucleus as vertebrates go. It only has maybe 40, 50,000 cells. The key thing is that it's a relatively simple structure that has projection neurons here labeled in red and interneurons labeled in green. Now, in addition to having an extremely stereotypical behavior, there is another thing that was discovered more than 10 years ago by Michael Fee, at MIT, which is very remarkable, which is the neurons that are involved in the production of the song, they are extremely dedicated to do one thing and one thing only. What do I mean by this? Okay, so here on top, you see the song. You can see these spectrograms that I have been showing you. In this case, it's a song that perhaps has maybe four syllables, A, B, C, and D. So when you record from an individual neuron, in this case, neuron one, that neuron is completely silent until the animal starts to sing syllable A, in this case. And that neuron is totally quiet for the rest of the song. Neuron two, it's active in the middle of syllable A. Neuron three is active a bit later. Number four, maybe it's starting to be active for the beginning of syllable B. And this is the important thing, maybe to make it more clear. So neuron number five, those tiny things that you can see, those are individual action potentials of the neuron over many, many, many repetitions. What is remarkable is how extremely precise it is that neuron 5, if the animal is singing, you know, 100 or 200 songs, is only going to be active for that part of the syllable and nothing else. Actually, to the degree that if the animal is not singing, that neuron is not firing at all. So we have both an extremely stereotypical behavior and neurons that have very precise firing patterns. Now, how can we study resilience taking advantage of these features? So this is the following idea. In a normal neuron, so you have here in a control neuron, you have these very typical action potentials, which is a hallmark of neuronal activity, which is the neurons becomes depolarized, becomes electrically active, and you can see that it's very sharp. It's, the width is only maybe like 5 milliseconds, and then after that, the neuron is quiet. Now, how can we make these neurons noisy? Because as I mentioned before, these neurons are actually very, very precise. Well, there are different ion channels that we can add into these neurons using different genetic methods. And one in particular that we have been using is an ion channel from bacteria called NACVAC, which is a sodium voltage-gated channel that when we add this additional ion channel to neurons, makes them noisy. What do I mean by this? So you can see the control neuron, as I mentioned, has this very sharp activity, only 5 milliseconds in width approximately. However, if in that same neuron we add this additional channel NACVAC, you can see that the neurons is much, much more noisy. First of all, the activity is not just this tiny window. The activity propagates for maybe like almost a whole second. And another, there doesn't seem to be any rhyme or reason in when the cell goes up or down. Basically, we can make a neuron noisy simply by delivering this ion channel into it. Now, so we have an animal that has a very stereotypical song with very precise neuronal activity. Now, what happens if we put this channel into the neurons, into this new nucleus that I mentioned before, HVC, these neurons that are so precise? What happens in terms of the ability of the animals, these animals, to produce song? Now, so one thing that is important is that we are putting this ion channel in a high percentage of these neurons, approximately 50 or 60%. You can see here in green, this virus is also labeled with GFP, so we can actually, at the end of the experiment, we can see the percentage of neurons that are labeled. Red is the total number of neurons. You can see that it's approximately 50%. And one thing that is important, we are selectively delivering this ion channel only to the projection neurons, here labeled in red. We are not doing anything to the so-called interneurons or inhibitory neurons. Okay, so what happens in terms of the behavior? In a normal animal, as I mentioned before, if you don't do anything, every rendition of the song is virtually identical to every previous one, even over long periods of time. You can see here an animal singing 4 songs. Basically, every single song is virtually identical. Now, if we put this ion channel, NACVAC, into these projection neurons in the part of the brain that produces the song, so what I'm going to show you now are spectrograms of the song of the same animal over a few days. So you can see that for a few days after we have added this channel that makes the neurons noisy, actually nothing happens. You can see that the song is the same 1 day before we do anything or 5 days later. However, by 8 days, you see that the song is very disorganized. By 10 days, it's very disorganized, and it actually doesn't even look like the song from the 8th day. 11th day is extremely disorganized. But curiously, by 12 days, the song has come back to almost identical as if it was before we did any manipulation of the animal. So what this means is that we have a very profound degradation and rapid recovery of behavior in a relatively short period of time, only 12 days. Let's see if I can play you what this song sounds like so that you have an idea. Okay, before we do any manipulation, this is what the song will sound like. Now, 8 days after the manipulation, this is what the song starts to sound. 10 days, and by 12 days, the song has recovered. And if you can notice, it sounds almost identical. I'm going to play now the song before we did any manipulation. So this is before we did manipulation. And this is 12 days after the manipulation. It's virtually identical. So now we have a situation in which, in a very short period of time, by making neurons noisy, the system completely falls apart, the behavior degrades completely, but is able to recover in a very short period of time, less than 2 weeks. Here is a quantification, and you can see in the next slide what it looks like. So you can see in a control animal in which we have done no manipulation, you can see that blue line on top, that basically this is the quality of the song over, let's say, 2 weeks. And you can see that the blue line is a flat line, it's straight, meaning that the song is good every day. However, in the animals in which we have done the genetic manipulation of injecting noise, you can see that the song degrades by the sixth day. It's actually highly degraded, but then starting on the 12th day, the song starts to come back, and by the 14th day, it's exactly as it was before we started the experiment. Now, of course, the question is, in addition to the phenomenon that the song is recovering, we want to understand how the neurons are able to do this feat of being able to recover a very precise behavior, even though 50% of the neurons are noisy. Remember that what we did is, for these neurons, the red neurons, the projection neurons, approximately 50% of them, we added this channel here in this cartoon represented by green, so that those neurons are noisy. So I'm going to show now some electrophysiological traces of recording of those neurons. In a normal animal, you can see this normal electrical activity, that you can see these peaks going up and down, again, very narrow, as this is what is called a normal action potential. And you can see that those neurons have actually a very low level of what is called synaptic inhibitory inputs. So basically, this is information that comes from other neurons that will tend to silence them. A normal neuron in a normal animal has very little of these synaptic inhibitory neurons. Now, in animals in which we have injected this channel knockback, there are actually going to be two types of neurons. There are going to be neurons that have this very abnormal electrical activity, very broad action potentials, but also next to them, they are going to be, sorry, I'm going to stay here. So what you can see is that these neurons that have knockback, they are receiving a very, very strong activity of inhibitory inputs. So the way to think about it is that if a neuron has this, is noisy, that neuron somehow is going to signal for other neurons to silence them. Basically, it is active because it has the channel, but because it's receiving many inhibitory inputs, presumably the final outcome of these two opposing trends is that that neuron will be silenced. Is that the case? Now, in a normal animal, so I'm going to talk about here about the inhibitory and excitatory inputs that these neurons receive. In a normal animal, of course, it's a control, so we just define that the excitatory inputs that are here on top of the line are 100%, the inhibitory inputs are 100%. Basically, this is our baseline. What happens in an animal in which we have delivered this ion channel into half of the neurons? So in an animal that has received this ion channel, we are going to have some neurons that have normal electrical activity, and some neurons that have this channel that makes them noisy. Now, so what is curious is that, as I mentioned before, the cells that have the channel here illustrated in green, they are receiving an enhanced inhibition. So basically, those neurons are going to be silenced. Perhaps this is not that surprising. If a neuron is very noisy, the neighboring neurons try to silence it so that the noise does not propagate throughout the circuit. However, the curious thing that was very unexpected for us is the blue traces or the blue bars. So what we see here is that those are neighboring neurons that do not have the channel that makes them noisy. And what we see is that even though we have not manipulated those neurons at all, you can see that the blue bar that is on top of the black horizontal bar, that actually significantly enhanced compared to either the knockback cell or even the cell from the control animal. So what this means is that the neighboring neurons, they are doing more. Basically, they are receiving more excitatory input than even a normal neuron. So a way to think about this in a very simplistic cartoon way would be something like this. In a normal animal, you have these projection neurons in red, they have the normal range of activity and the animal sings a normal song. Everything is good. If we put this channel that makes the neurons noisy, here illustrated by that green neuron, now there is extra activity, there is too much activity in the circuit, the song does come out right, this is not a good situation. Now, the next thing that is going to happen is that somehow the system is going to detect that the green neurons are too active, they are going to be inhibited by other neurons around, and basically they are going to be being eliminated from the circuit. They are not going to have a pernicious activity on the circuit. However, now the problem is that you are going from a situation on top in which you have, like in this cartoon, three projection neurons active to only two projection neurons active, and one has been silent. So this is not good enough. The song is actually wrong. Now, the final outcome is two things happen. You can see that the two remaining unmanipulated neurons, because they are receiving more excitatory inputs, now those are doing more job, what we mentioned in a very informal way. The remaining neurons are picking up the slack for the activity of the neurons that had been silenced. And eventually, with these types of compensations, you can have a recovery of the song with a normal outcome, a normal song, even though you only have, let's say, half of the neurons that remain that had not been genetically manipulated. By the way, we were interested in figuring out if this was only like specific for the type of manipulation that we were doing with ion channel. We did another modification with a genetic construct that actually directly blocks the flow of neuronal activity. It's called tetanus toxin. What this gene does is to eliminate the ability of neurons to release neurotransmitter through synapses. We do the same experiment. We inject it into these projection neurons in nucleus HVC. And what we see is the following. As I mentioned before, for the experiments with NACVAC, you saw that there was this degradation in red and then recovery after 2 weeks. If we do a genetic silencing of these excitatory neurons, we see almost an identical trend in the sense that the song degrades, and then after approximately 2 weeks, it comes back. The only thing is that you can see that the degradation is a bit faster, simply because this tetanus toxin is more active than NACVAC, so there is no delay from the moment that we put the virus until we have the modification. So basically, we have a situation in which either abnormally noisy or silencing them produces both a degradation and a rapid recovery of the song. How does this work? What is the mechanism by which the system is able to reorganize? In short, we don't know, and this is a very, very important question, which is a fundamental aspect of neuroscience is the production of sequence. Like, for instance, you know, whenever we are riding a bicycle, you have to, or you're walking or almost any motor activity, you have to produce activities in a sequence, in a sequential order. We actually don't know very well what is the neuronal architecture that is responsible for these sequences. There are two very, very silly cartoons here that I have suggested we think about. Adrienne will talk in more detail about putting some numbers into these models. So one could be that there could be a local generation of sequences in the same way that if you have a set of domino pieces, once one falls, the next one falls, the next one falls. And you can imagine how does this relate to our experiments. If we are eliminating half of the pieces in one of these domino sets, once one piece falls, the next one is not going to fall. How is it possible that the song can recover? Well, perhaps if there is some reshuffling, rewiring of the pieces of domino, or in this case, pieces of neurons that are left, maybe you can keep producing the song simply by keeping those elements toppling each other. So that one model is the local generation of sequence. And another one is a bit more complicated, which is a cyclical generation of sequence. In this model, the idea would be that to produce, let's say, syllable A, there has to be a number of transformations, you know, from a circle to a octagon, to a pentagon, to a, you know, in this case, a circle. And then only after you are done with that, then you move to the next one, and then you produce syllable B, and you have this series of transformations, and then after you are done, you go to syllable C. So the key element here is that it's not like the domino that one piece immediately topples the next one. Here is, before you go to syllable B, there has to be a number of things happening in syllable A, and there has to be a long-range connection outside of where the initial transformation are happening for each syllable that has to happen before you can go to the next syllable. Now, in our experiments, what we are doing is we are eliminating many of these nodes for the ones that are, in this case, for instance, to produce syllable A, these like purple elements. Now, if you cannot produce syllable A, if it does not complete, there is no next step, so you don't produce B, C, etc. How can that, in this model, how could the song recover? Well, perhaps if even if you have half of the neurons that produce A, but if those are somehow strengthened, then you can produce syllable A, and that will go for the next step, etc., etc. Okay, so this concludes the part of the experiments that we have been doing in my lab at Caltech. So next, it will be the experiments performed by in the lab of Tim Gardner at University of Oregon.
All right, my name is Tim Gardner. I'm a faculty member at the University of Oregon, and I'm going to continue what Carlos was describing, going into a little bit more detail about the neural mechanisms of song production and what we hope to study in this question about the basis of song resilience. I've been fascinated by this question for many years, and I think this really began for me looking at some of the songs of another species. These are canary songs, and we demonstrated many years ago that a canary raised in acoustic isolation can still self-organize a pretty clear song structure, something that looks quite normal. And you can see that here over the course of time, from a very early plastic song through crystallized adult song, even in the absence of imitation. So the song learning process really is an imitation process that's also built on top of a self-organization, a remarkable dynamical system that emerges and builds itself spontaneously to produce stereotype songs. And so we think that the neuronal mechanisms of the recovery process may share some similarities with these intrinsic self-organization processes that underlie the growth and development of song. This is just some eye candy work that I had done with Carlos Lois earlier at when I was a postdoc at MIT. We were able to track the development of neurons over the course of a few days. And so this just illustrates the fact that as the bird is learning to sing, the song circuit is spontaneously rewiring and organizing and building itself under rules that are still to be determined. Carlos mentioned there's a well-defined circuit for song. And in particular, this nucleus HVC that he described is the site of the viral perturbations that formed the first part of this talk. It's a remarkably clear circuit that is involved in the generation of sequences. And this work from Mike Long in the Phi Lab is a really nice illustration of that. Just cooling that region of the brain, a bird's song can slow by a factor of 30 or 40% with just a couple degrees cooling. So very specific effects on song. HVC is also the site of this very precise temporal sequence first described also in the Phi Lab Carlos mentioned earlier. And so it's really this circuit that we would like to zoom in on as part of the next questions. And I'm going to give you a little background. Work that Carlos mentioned in the lab is also imaging with small miniature microscopes. And this is a technique that was introduced by Mark Schnitzer at Stanford. And we've adapted that, made some smaller versions of the microscope that can be easily carried by songbirds. And we focus on this nucleus HVC at the top surface of the brain, which is accessible with these miniature microscopes. Microscope is capable of imaging the projection neurons in HVC. These are the cells that fire sparsely. And one of the beauties of that sparse firing is that the relatively slow calcium indicators that are used in modern neuroscience can still resolve the firing times of individual cells because they fire sparsely. And this is kind of a technical point, but for our purposes, that is illustrated here. Basically, each one of these traces contains sample activity patterns in individual cells that were recorded with that miniature microscope in HVC, the song nucleus. And as you can see, although the time course of the response is somewhat slower than the action potentials, which are very brief, you can still localize the onset of each of those bursts of action potential thanks to the sparse firing patterns. The cells recorded in HVC, these projection neurons, in a single bird now, we can observe in a single song a sequence of up to 50, or in this case, 70 different cells that all fire in a very organized sequence as the bird sings. Now, Carlos introduced this question, showing this image, asking what is the basis of this behavioral stability. The remarkable pattern of activity that produces the bird song is perhaps stable as well. And this really is the first question that we want to ask with the miniature microscopes. So looking just at a first recording over the course of a few days, you can see that the pattern of firing in the sequential activity of the cells are roughly preserved over the course of 1 to 5 days. And you can see that with these miniature microscopes implanted over HVC. This next slide illustrates the, I think, a very useful way of demonstrating that the pattern is essentially stable underlying the production of song over the course of multiple days. And here what we've done is colored the image that's recorded with the miniature microscope according to the time that a cell was active in the song. So these are two different birds on top and bottom with songs recorded 5 days apart. So on the left is the first recording, and on the right is another recording 5 days later for two birds. And what you see is that the pattern of colors is essentially preserved over that time interval. And here the color denotes when in the song a cell or a pixel in that image was activated. Early in the song is blue and late in the song is red. And so you can see that the cells that fired early in the song on the first day, 5 days later, are once again firing early, and the cells that fired late in the song are once again firing late, with some minor shifts in apparent here. So this really indicated to us that the pattern underlying the stability of song could in fact be stable. The timing of action potentials from these projection neurons, as indicated by this miniature microscope, are in fact quite stable over the course of multiple days. However, we've noticed in rare recordings with electrodes that occasionally a cell that fires a couple times per song may gradually increase or decrease the probability of firing. And so here, for example, is a recording of a single cell that fires twice per song towards the end of a day of recording. But earlier in that same day, that cell was only firing once per song. And in the top graph, you can actually see the fade out of action potential. The second action potential is basically fading in or growing in probability over the course of that day of singing. And so this turned out to be quite common in the cells that we recorded with these miniature microscopes. So looking a bit more closely, we could record a pattern of which cells were active on a given day, and then ask, so here on day one, we would color the activity of all of the active pixels in an image red. And then on the next day, color all of the active pixels green. And then on the third day, color them blue. What you see in an image like this is, I think, quite compelling. The indication is that some cells, the ones that show a bright white center, are really consistent over the course of all 3 days. And this really indicates that our firing patterns are stably tracked over these days, and that the microscope is imaging a consistent plane and a consistent field of view, that some of these cells show very consistent positioning and over the course of all 3 days. However, there are other cells, such as the red one at the bottom, that are only active on the first day, or cells that may be purple, for example, in the kind of middle left, that are active on two of the days, but not all 3 days. And so what this study revealed was that the although the song remains the same in a zebra finch adult that's unperturbed, stable, the underlying neuronal representation of that song may actually undergo some turnover in the participation of projection neurons, which are these excitatory neurons that encode the song. This is something that we had to be extremely careful to be certain that the cells that we were looking at were not shifting out of our field of view, or that we had some instability in our imaging process. And the image here, I think, really quite clearly summarizes that. The fact that some of the cells are stable, showing consistent white patterns, while others are colored, indicates that we have stable imaging some turnover in the population of neurons that are active in a given song on a given day. Here's another image from another bird, or perhaps from the same bird, slightly different processing. These are images from two additional birds. So that pattern really was consistent, that although the song is stable, the projection neurons in HVC that produce that song appear to shift, have some probability of shifting over the course of just 3 days. So on some fraction of these cells, I believe on the order of 20% or slightly more, show really significant changes in the probability of firing over the course of a few days. So we believe this is really important baseline information in the study that Carlos described earlier with the viral perturbations. We essentially would like to track how the brain recovers from a perturbation and what the self-organizing rules are. But in order to do that and ask that question meaningfully, we really need to understand the baseline stability of firing patterns. So this describes a potential instability in projection neurons that, the story is further intriguing by the observation that the shift that we see in those projection neuron participation profiles occurs primarily over intervals of sleep. So the song patterns are stable within a day, but then overnight, many of the shifts are apparent. And that's something that we can quantify here on a 24-hour timeline showing consistency of song or calcium patterns that show the circadian pattern of shift over intervals of sleep. All right, so that describes just one cell type in HVC. And the other really important class of neurons is the group of inhibitory neurons that we can't record with the calcium indicators because, as shown from this slide from Michael Fee's lab, in the middle, the interneurons show dense firing patterns that cannot be tracked with the relatively slow timescales of the calcium indicators. To ask the same question about neuronal stability from the inhibitory neurons, it was necessary to use electrodes. But traditionally, electrodes are somewhat large and introduce a glial scar in the vicinity of the implant. And so we really can't use electrodes that are used in humans, for example, or larger animal electrodes to stably record firing patterns in these very small inhibitory neurons in songbirds. And so this project is part of an ongoing effort to develop new smaller electrodes and smaller methods, more less invasive methods for recording from small animal models in neuroscience. Some of the efforts have gone into carbon fiber electrodes, or in collaboration with Stuart Kogan at the University of Texas in Dallas, some silicon carbide microneedles that are much smaller than traditional electrodes used in neuroscience applications. So now, armed with these miniature electrodes, we are able to now target this distinct class of neuron, the inhibitory neuron, and ask this question. And to make a long story short, the inhibitory neurons, for as long as we are able to record, we see stability in the firing pattern. So this is illustrated here, tracking three inhibitory neurons in HVC. On the left for 10 days, middle for 16, and on the right for 124 days. What is apparent is that there's a very distinct firing pattern. Each row in those images corresponds to a single song. It looks like a barcode, and that appearance really is related to the stability of the firing pattern of those inhibitory neurons. Similarly, local field potentials, these are commonly used in EEG or other forms of signal processing that you might be familiar with. These local field potentials are also stable over the course of days here for three separate days, or even here out to 500 days on the left and 252 days on the right. So we see at the level of inhibitory neurons and mesoscopic patterns measured by local field potentials, a sign of stability in the firing patterns. And this really is kind of brought together in this slide here, though we don't have a lot of data on this, but inhibitory neurons that were recorded in the same bird in a single small volume frequently showed very tightly correlated gaps in the firing pattern. So you can see here illustrated on the left, these kind of coherent pauses in the firing patterns of those inhibitory neurons. And to make a long story short here, the two classes of cells that we recorded in this study are very tightly linked together. So if we look at the timing of the inhibitory neurons and the timing of the excitatory neurons, they fall out of phase with each other in a 30 hertz rhythm. So you know, I guess to kind of summarize these observations, this baseline study looked at these two classes of cells and found on the one hand, on the mesoscopic scale, and that's illustrated on the right, the pattern of song is very stable as represented by inhibitory neurons or local field potentials. But then on the microscopic scale, these very small projection neurons, these sparse firing projection neurons, show some probability of fading out or fading in to the participation of song over intervals of sleep. And so we think that this kind of opens the door for new models of sequence generation and also new models of song resilience, and essentially a hypothesis that there is both a mesoscopic or intermediate scale code for song in the brains of a zebrafinch, as well as this more microscopic code that perhaps shows more turnover. And we think that further work is required to really develop models around this. I think this is something that Adrian Fairhol will be talking about next, related to mathematical models of how the resilience of the code might be represented in this nucleus HVC. So my own lab's work as part of this project, we're involved in some of this modeling effort, but now primarily on continuing to develop new tools that will allow us to track the patterns of activity in HVC more stably. And this takes the form of new microscopes, for example. This multicolor miniature microscope is going to allow us to identify cell types specifically within the excitatory neuron population, so which cells project to one region of the songbird brain and which cells project to another. We can label with a second color and then image that with these new miniature microscopes. And the second area is ongoing work to develop new miniature electrode arrays that can give us more stable recordings and higher yield of signal over the course of time. And the ultimate goal of that is to record through a perturbation, the viral perturbation that Carlos described earlier, and basically document the patterns of activity in the nucleus at the outset of an experiment, and then through the onset of the expression of the genes that alter the pattern of activity in HVC, and then over the course of time as HVC recovers and rebuilds, and according to principles that are still very mysterious, self-organizes a resilient pattern that is not required for which hearing is not required. So I think, as Carlos mentioned, our evidence at this point suggests that this recovery process is not dependent on self-perception or hearing. And so much of this is, I think, best described by Adrian in the next section. And with that, I'll close and pass it on to Adrian Fairhall, who has been taking on the mathematical modeling side of this work.
Thanks, Tim, for the introduction, and I will indeed be talking about theoretical approaches to this project. And it's really a pleasure to be able to be involved in this project, because birdsong has been, you know, a classic model for quite a long time for theorists to think about models of learning, in particular reinforcement learning. So we've been talking a lot about HVC, which contains the sequence that organizes song. HVC drives a downstream region, RA, which is a premotor region, and that connection between HVC and RA is the one that has to learn, you know, to drive that motor output. And we believe that's done through the injection of fluctuations from LMAN, and those fluctuations are reinforced at the HVC to RA synapse in order to learn a good song. So the questions that my lab have been working on were inspired by Tim's work, and are looking forward to trying to understand some of the very interesting experimental findings that you've been seeing both from Carlos and Tim. So one major question is, how do the variations in HVC that that Tim just talked about, what functional role do they have? How might they affect song learning and song maintenance? And then the bigger question of the joint project is, what restores sequence production in HVC after perturbation? And I'll tell you about a couple of different strategies that we've been taking to look at that. So we'd like to ask, how do these HVC variations affect robustness of song learning and production? So we've seen already that there is a sequence generated by neurons in HVC, as I just said, that they drive neurons in RA that are responsible for motor production. Those neurons get inputs from LMAN that we think about as random fluctuations. That drives a motor output. And we believe that the bird, in assessing that motor output, can then, the bird brain can then send a reinforcement signal that in some way is able to affect the strength of the wiring between HVC and RA. And so in order to explore the consequences of Tim's findings, what we did was to take our HVC neurons as a sequence. At the moment, we're not worrying about how that sequence is generated, and introduce perturbations of the type that you saw already. So from day to day, we're going to allow some of those neurons to stop firing, to not fire in the sequence as they had been thought to do. And so we can look at the quality of the song that the bird produces. And in red, what you're seeing is how the error in the song goes down throughout a reinforcement learning paradigm over time. And you can see there's initially high error, and that eventually reduces and stays at a constant low level. When we introduce perturbations, as you're seeing in black, that error will, you know, let's zoom in, will take these spikes as the perturbations are introduced, but then through the learning process, the error reduces again. But what you should see is that it never gets down to quite the low level that you get in the absence of perturbation. And we can quantify that. We can look at how much change in error there is over the course of learning without perturbation, with zero perturbations. And then what happens is we increase the rate of perturbations. And you can see that indeed, as you can see by eye there, the error improvement is always worse, right? The final song is always a tiny bit worse than it is in the absence of perturbation. So why might a system want to do this if it does take a hit in the quality of the song that's eventually produced? And we saw a couple of potential reasons why that might be a good idea. So one is that if you now require the motor output to be different, so let's say originally the bird learnt the song, the motor output that's drawn there in black, now we're going to ask it to relearn a song. So let's imagine that, say, the motor pathway was damaged in some way, and so the bird wants to continue to produce a good song, but now using its vocal system a little bit differently. So how does the system do in learning that perturbation? So now what you can see is that in the absence of having trained with perturbation, the time to learn the new song is quite long. So this is in arbitrary units here, but say 300 repetitions required to get to a certain error rate. As we increase the number of perturbations in the original training of the song, you see that it takes considerably less time for the bird to be able to learn that perturbed song. So we've generated a learning circuit that is more robust and is more able to learn perturbations that might occur as the animal is, say, aging or experiences some kind of damage. Furthermore, it's also more robust immediately to neuron death. So let's say we take our original socket, and now maybe the animal experiences, again, some injury, or there's a neuron is ablated or dies for some reason in that motor premotor pathway in nucleus RA. Clearly, that is going to cause a perturbation in the song output. And if we look at how much error is induced by ablating neurons in RA, so again, you see for the unperturbed network, the one trained with zero perturbations, there is a considerable error that's incurred after neurons in RA are ablated. And that error from ablation gets smaller and smaller as we increase the number of perturbations. And so it appears that by training the network in the presence of what we put in was quite a small fraction, as you know, can imagine from Tim's results, maybe 5% of neurons that turn over night by night, we have ended up with a network that's much more robust. It's more able to learn new songs, and it's able to withstand damage. So we wanted to look into the structure of the trained network to understand why that might be. And what you're seeing here are the synaptic weight matrices between HVC and RA for the network trained without any perturbations, and one trained in the presence of this sort of nightly turnover of neurons. And you can see immediately that there's a big difference in the structure of those matrices. So without perturbation, there are a lot of correlations between the weights in the matrix. And with perturbation, those correlations are broken down. And so what that tells us is that we've learned a trained network that maybe avoids sort of the overfitting that's happened in the network without perturbation. And this might be thought as an analogy to the kinds of things that people do now in training artificial neural networks, where they use dropout to get rid of some of the nodes in order to avoid overfitting. So here we feel like what we've shown is that without that perturbation, you're going to end up with a network that is sort of overfit and thus sort of overtrained for a particular song output. All right, let's turn to exploring the questions that Carlos raised. You know, how does, what are the mechanisms within HVC that allow it to restore sequence production, not just after these little perturbations night by night, but after the dramatic sorts of perturbations that he's been introducing experimentally? And so one model was this sort of domino model whereby neurons within HVC trigger one another in a chain-like fashion. And so our initial pass at looking at this is to more or less build that model as stated. We have set up a chain of excitatory neurons, so populations of excitatory neurons that drive one another in sequence. And they are all sort of globally, or at least at the mesoscopic level, as Tim would put it, coupled to an inhibitory pool. And that's very important. The inhibitory group are very important in order to produce the kind of sparse firing such that only one neuron group is firing at a time. And so that model generates for us quite well the kinds of spike trains that you saw in the experimental data. So the neurons in these pools fire in a nice sparse sequence, and the inhibitory neurons shown below fire, you know, at times strewn throughout the song. And now we can use this network to explore the implications of the kinds of experimental manipulations that Carlos has been doing. So we can ablate a fraction of the excitatory neurons. And what we've been looking at is the possibility that a mechanism known as homeostatic plasticity might be underlying the recovery that you observe. And so after ablating the neurons, what we do is to allow the synapses to rescale. So initially, the synaptic weights coming in are, you know, set to a certain level. Once we ablate the neurons, we then allow the remaining synapses to increase their synaptic weights such that the total input coming into the neuron is approximately the same. So if we look at the consequences of that, here we're looking at the network where we've ablated 10% of the neurons. And you can see that actually this model is relatively robust on its own. With 10% ablation, you still get a reasonable sequence through the network. But if we now add on to that the synaptic scaling mechanism, now the network is able to recover quite well over time, such that that sequence is able to propagate more or less undisturbed through the network. if we ablate 30% of the neurons, that's a much more significant effect. And now, similar to the experiments, the sequence becomes unable to propagate through the network. But after time, given synaptic scaling, it's able to recover. And that even with that much reduced number of neurons in the chain, it's able to recover the ability to propagate the sequence. So open questions relative to this part of the project. We still would like to understand the experimentally observed changes in synaptic waves that Carlos has shown. We'd like to understand not just the ablation question, but the case when the neurons are perturbed with knockbacks so that they become sort of problematic in their firing properties. How does the network sort of identify and excise those problematic neurons from the chain? And finally, we're starting to analyze the statistics of the perturbed song itself to see if that can tell us more about the intrinsic chain structure. So the other model that Carlos proposed is that there may be some external coordination of spike sequences in HVC, such that you might get little subsequences, but they are coordinated from the outside by some kind of modulatory input. So it turns out there is a region of the bird brain that's ideally situated to play that role, and that's area UVA. So that inputs from area UVA are required into HVC in order for the bird to sing. So the picture that we had was that perhaps UVA can serve as sort of a modulatory network that gives a time-locked input into HVC that would help to coordinate the timing of perhaps independent parts of the sequence within HVC, that network might help to play the role, as I've drawn here, of sort of a metronome that keeps that sequence time locked and coordinates subsequences within HVC. UVA has the structure that one would like for it to play the role of a song organizer. So you see these again beautiful data from Michael Fee's lab. We're looking at traces from UVA where you see its activity is not particularly highly instructive of the structure of the syllables themselves, but instead has these strong inputs at the time of the pauses between the syllables. And if one records from several locations through UVA, what you see is that this is sort of a global signal that all of UVA seems to be producing this same time-locked signal. So we took a simple model. We drove our network, our chain network, very similar to before, with UVA, assuming that what it's providing to the network is sort of a temporally modulated global input. And we combined that, and this is necessary, with spatially structured inhibition, so that as time goes by, different regions of the network are receiving inhibitory inputs. And what we were able to show, and this is work by my postdoc Rich Pang, was that this structure allows timing within a pretty sloppy network, which may not intrinsically maintain very high temporal precision. If we add this combination to the network, that reduces the timing variability across the network beautifully. And so in a normal chain network, one finds that the precision of timing can kind of distribute as one moves through the sequence. Here, UVA can play a role of maintaining that high timing precision throughout the song. And furthermore, that it can help to synchronize subsequences within the song. There are still a lot of open questions with this part of the project as well. One is that if we take, say, naturalistic UVA input, can this appropriate spatial structure of inhibition self-organize itself via synaptic plasticity? And sort of the big open question that I think Carlos beautifully raised, you know, what's the role of motor feedback into UVA? UVA's part of a feedback loop from the motor output. How does that sort of work as a coordinated loop, closed loop to maintain some precision? So that's where I will end, and I'll hand back to Carlos.
Okay, so we have heard about the experiments that were done in my lab at the beginning of the talk, the experiments that were done in Tim Gardner's lab regarding the neurobiological properties of these neurons and their stability. Finally, from the theoretical work in Adrienne Ferhal's lab with the question of theoretical models about the stability. Now we are trying to put all of these threads together for in the future, and we want to concentrate for the next few years in the following three questions. One is time-specific genetic manipulations. Second is analysis of circuit reorganization in real time. And third, theoretical models of circuit reorganization. So let me explain what I mean by this. For time-specific genetic manipulations, as I mentioned at the beginning, the manipulations that we have been doing so far, either genetic injection of noise or silences of neurons so that information is not transferred from one neuron to the next, those are manipulations that basically are constant all the time. From the moment that we put the virus into the neurons, we have no control of when it's happening. We would like to be able to do two types of manipulations, either silencing or injecting noise, but we want to do it with much more precision than we have been able to do it before. We want to do it for specific times. For instance, what we want to do is we want to silence these neurons that we have been talking before, either when the animal is singing or when the animal is, we have not mentioned it before, but there is a very interesting observation that these animals basically, they dream the song when they are sleeping. So that's, it's called night replay. So we want to silence the activity of these neurons when the animal is singing or when the animal is doing this night replay. And this presumably will be able to tell us something about what is the role of this night replay for the stability of the song. In the same way, we want to do genetic injection of noise, but we want to do it in specific times. For instance, I mentioned before that these neurons are very specific. They are very particular in one way. They are only active when the animal is singing, and moreover, when the animal is singing, they are only active for a specific syllable, and they are not active at all for the rest of the song. So what we want to do is we want to do genetic injection of noise only when the animal is singing a specific syllable, for instance. Or we want to do another variation, which is we want to do injection of noise when the animal is awake but not singing. Remember that these neurons are not supposed to be active if the animal is not singing. And again, we also want to inject noise into these neurons when the animal is dreaming of the song during night replay. So these are experiments that we are now developing the technology to be able to do so that we can combine these two threads, basically genetic manipulation of neurons, either by silencing or injecting noise, but to be able to do it time-locked to specific behavioral events in the life of the animal. Another critical question is that I mentioned some of the initial results that we have regarding the synaptic properties of the reorganization, but these are things that happen after the process of the recovery has occurred. What we would like to do is we would like to see what is the activity of neurons in an animal, in the same animal, before we do a manipulation, after we do the manipulation when the song is degraded. We want to see in real time when the song is recovery and after it recovers. These are going to be technically very challenging experiments, but this is a close collaboration with team that we are developing new methods so that we can see we can do at the same time genetic manipulation and long-term recording of neuronal activity of neurons in the same animal for a long period of time, let's say 2 or 3 weeks, so that we can see what happens to the same neurons over long periods of time. And finally, we are also very interested in pursuing more theoretical models of circuit reorganization, because that could give us some clues about further experiments that we can do to ask more precise questions, obviously in collaboration with Adrienne. So as I mentioned, one of the critical things about all these questions is that we don't really know very well the architecture of this part of the brain that generates these sequences. So a very important unknown here is the reorganization that we have seen about this perturbation. Is it a local property of the circuit? Remember this naive model that I mentioned about the dominoes. Or alternatively, how much of other parts of the circuits, Adrienne mentioned this particular nucleus called UBA, in this cyclical model, with the idea that the production of sequences is not something that just occurs in one small part of the brain, this nucleus HPC, but it's actually distributed over several nuclei in the brain, And before you go to the next step, you have to go through a complete cycle through this other nuclei. And then finally, a very critical question that also Tim mentioned, there is something that we think that is very mysterious by the fact that these animals are able to recover their song after these manipulations that we have been doing, even if the animals are not hearing what they are doing, or even more, if we prevent the animals from singing. So basically, we do not give the, after the manipulation, if we do not give the animals the opportunity to produce song, even after 2 weeks, they are able to produce a recover song. So what this means is that this recovery happens offline without any type of feedback. How is that possible? That is something that we don't understand, and Adrienne will generate theoretical models to try to explain how this is possible. Okay, so as you notice, I mean, this is a very complicated project that has, in which three labs are participated. So very briefly, I will just mention, you can see that there is a large number of people involved in this project. So this is my lab at Caltech. The people that are here with those red circles have been participating in this project. Then I'm going to mention the people in Adrienne Ferskow's lab. Again, these are people doing the theoretical models, in addition to David Perkel, that is a collaborator in another lab in University of Washington. And finally, we have here the people that have participated in this project in the lab of Tim Gardner, a number of graduate students, postdocs, technicians. As you can see, this is a very large project that has involved many people with many different types of expertise, and it has been very fruitful, and we are looking forward for the next few years to see what are these mysteries of this reorganization of the brain after damage. And I hope that these explanations that we have provided here gave an idea of what we think that this model of the brain as a, you know, a river in which the information can keep going, even if there are obstacles along the way, could be a valuable model to think about how the brain is able to first produce stable behaviors over long periods of time, and second, perhaps give an idea of how this could be useful to take advantage of these mechanisms for the recovery of brain function after different diseases. Thank you very much.